Hi folks, Bonnie Steinsnyder here. I'm going to lay down some soft washes in preparation for doing some negative painting. So first, I'm going to make myself a nice loose puddle of a Hansa yellow and phthalo blue. And I'm just going to put that in nice and lightly over some areas. I can use some water to direct things. Now I think I'm going to drop in some blue over here. Ooh, hello, my brush wasn't clean on that. Rinse, knock off the excess. Now I'm gonna come in with some of that pyrrole red that I've been using. I'm going to come in like this. It's okay to have some of the reds in areas that are underneath the greens. It's okay to have some green in areas that are dark for the red. You want something interesting in this wash that's underneath the negative painting. So I'm just having a good time. I'm letting gravity do a little bit of the work here, but I want to keep things loose. Now, even though that looks fairly dark, it's not. This is all very wet, and when wet dries, it is going to get very pale. Let's see. Now you don't have to go wall to wall with this. You can leave some white of page. And if I wanted to come back and leave some white of page, well, let's see what I can do. That's getting a little bit. I'm in my studio. I can make a mess. Ha 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 ha. Let's see. If I wanted to clear out a little bit of that wash, I'll just do that. If I wanted to clear out a little bit of that. Now the phthalo blue is staining a little bit, which doesn't really bother me because that's not the focal point. Oh, all my students get to see what a slob I am. I don't want to slow down. If I'm coming in and putting in colors and flowing them, I don't want to slow down. So let's see. I think I do want to I kind of like the way that that's, I think I want to get a little bit of blue in there in the under painting. Let me get some blue in there in the underpainting. Yeah. Okay. Now you can rock the paper. Get some interesting stuff going with this. Let gravity help you a bit. And then pull up that excess. Now, if you're at home, or even in your studio, your workspace, any workspace is a studio. Just, you know, you don't have to live in a puddle of water. It's okay. This is the first layer. So, this is the soft wash that I have that I can start putting negative paint in on top of and building up. What I do is, you know, I look, I find some of my middle tones, darks and middle tones. I can come in with some areas. Now again, this isn't going to be my darkest dark. Some people do come in at this point and start really coming in with darks. but I can come in and I'm not being too particularly careful right now. I want to just go quickly so that you can see this and know that you don't have to be precious with it. You can have fun. Fun is okay. Could even lay in a few more washes in here. Whee! Now this is what I mean by letting a wet in wet area just move. You know, you can let gravity be your friend for a change. Gravity has a lot to answer for. But I can rock this back and forth, and you can see that. Let's see if I can get the angle right so that you can see there's a nice glaze, this washy glaze on top of what's going on over there. I'm just gonna dry my brush off a little bit. Bring that edge in a little cleaner. Okay. I can come in here. La 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 la. Let me go in a little bit darker. This is still a middle tone. You know, it's gonna dry and it will be a middle tone. Okay, let's see if I want to come in. I'll keep that edge. Don't want to keep that edge? Yeah, I think I want to keep that edge. I can always darken it later. But I think maybe I'm going to drop a little bit of red in there. I think I'm going to go with an alizarin crimson. Because I know the flowers are going to have some reds in them. So I want this kind of purpley wash under there. Now remember, if you're rocking the wash on that side, this side's also moving. Just to make life interesting. And having the drips that come down, oh, that can be fun too. I actually think I'm going to pick up some of this color in here. Now, I was telling folks about graded washes, and if I want to have a little bit of a graded wash in here, I can soften this edge. I can just come in like that, and now that's going to go from pale into dark. I have to be careful though, if I touch that, it's just gonna all flow down, which could be fun, truth be told. I'm just moving that paint to the other side. Okay, so I can come in with some stronger darks here. Now I had a drawing down. First and foremost, it makes life so much easier if you're working in a more representational vein, if you sort of know what you want. Let's see. I think I'm just gonna come in there with some alizarin. Whee! Some blue in there and just let it flow. Now I'm going to be coming in with greens in here, and the greens are going to go right over these purples, but they're going to, this wash underneath is going to unify everything. And if I want to soften an edge, I can do that. I'm letting that bead go around. I think at this point, I'm going to pull this bead off. Blot the brush and pull it off. This one, though, I'm still working with. I think I want to keep going with that alizarin and phthalo blue purple. I was kind of enjoying that. But I think I'm going to swing over to a green soon. Still rocking things. Still letting the water move over the paper based on where I'm holding the paper, which angle I'm holding it. Do I want that light or dark? I think I'm going to keep it like that. Now, the more planning you do with this, you know, the more meticulous your layering can come out, which is wonderful if you've got the brain for that. If you are a more spontaneous painter, then just coming in and letting the watercolor surprise you is also a wonderful way of working. It all depends what kind of, you know, just what kind of joy your hand has in making these moves, what kind of joy your brain has in seeing the water flow versus getting a controlled image. It's all good. Aside from the fact that I can't get my brush to form a point. So I can drop that in. About now, you might be wondering, what on earth am I working from? Because I'm talking about a representational painting, so I'll pull this off my wall. This is the image I'm working from. Okay, so I've dried this, and I'm ready to go in for another pass. So I'd come in, I'd build up my darks a little bit more. If I wanted to come in with some dark blue-green, I could start coming in with that to build up the darks. Now, I haven't worked into the flowers at all, which I'm itching to do. But first, I want to just get myself a little bit more of the dark so I have a better idea of where I'm going with the value structure in those flowers. Now, I know I've got a lot of blooms in here because I really let the watercolor be very wet and wet backgrounds happen, and I kind of love that. I love it when the watercolor has its own action. And you can come in and drop in extra color into these wet areas, for instance. Let me drop in color into a wet area and just let some strong darks move around in the damp paint. So I'm still letting gravity do a lot of the work. Let's see. Where else am I going to put that blue? Because I don't want it to just be focused there. So I'm going to build up the darks. Then I might come in a few places and start developing the flowers and work back and forth that way. For this dark in here, which I was building up, I think I want to take those leaves with it. So instead of just letting it be all on its own some, I'm going to build up those darks and just let that dark run. And then come in, build up the edge of that petal. I think I might want to put some of this dark into some of those other petals. Let's see what I want. I'm encouraging a lot of loose paint movements running over the edges of different areas of color, forming blooms in certain areas. That's a nice bloom edge. This makes some people very unhappy because it's not a very controlled thing. But on the other hand, you get the flow of the paint. It's all good. It's just a matter of what kind of artist do you want to be? Yeah, what kind of paint handling gives you joy? I think I actually want to just come right in with that color, right over that flower. I see the edge. I'm not going to lose that edge. I think I'm just going to bring that blue right up over this negative space in there. It's an awful lot of fun building layers like this. It really is. Because you don't necessarily know what you're going to get with it. And sometimes the happy accidents, oh, it always makes me nervous saying happy accidents. Sometimes they are just luscious. And unless you let the paint go, you won't get that. So in here, I'm developing some really interesting little blooms and some beautiful glows. This is building up the painting in a negative fashion. I'm building up these flowers by painting around them and painting into the shadows a little bit. Eventually, I'll come in and start glazing in a few touches of some vivid quinacridone reds, some quinacridone magentas, maybe even a few cadmium reds to give it a little bit of warmth and brightness in the light. I'm beginning to build up some shadows in here where I'm going over a flower petal, building up a shadow, and then I'm letting that color just come right over the edge over the underpainting that I have over this wash that was already there. So now there's a soft edge between that petal and that shape. When I put in the color for this petal, this edge, that little puddled edge, will also soften a bit. Okay, you can see how I'm building up certain areas of dark. I'm letting them run over areas of light. I still have that wash, that initial wash coming through. unifying things and creating an atmosphere. Now I can go into the flowers in a few areas. I do not have to be an absolute realist about this. I don't have to copy the photo. I can look at the painting and see what it wants me to do. If I want to drop in areas of color and just be free about it with the flowers, okay, so here's a petal that might work better in some loose wash. And I'll just drop in some loose wash. Now the fun thing is, if I want to drop in a more vivid color, say I want to come in with some pyrrole red in there. I've got a dilute pyrrole red there. Now I'm going to pull up this little bit of density at the end of that petal, just so that it doesn't flood out. So each of these areas of flower, and it doesn't have to be each petal, you can choose several. So if I wanted to come in and find the form within this one, I could do it. I'm just going to let it go right over what I have. This will just be some nice loose pyrrole red. Very dilute, so it's going to be very pale. I'm just going to let that run on down. I'm tilting the paper. I'm letting it head south. I don't want to pick up too much of this puddle of water at the end of this petal, otherwise I'll lose all my color. But if you do this, you'll have sort of a beautiful free quality to your painting, which is a nice thing to do. Let's say I wanted to do this one down here, just in a single pass with a single color. I'm going to come in, I'm going to mix a little of the alizarin with some phthalo blue, just a smidgen. Okay, now I've already got a shadow in there. Hey, what say we would just let this thing drip on down? So I'm going over the whole flower. This is going to flavor that area, which is fine. I'm just going to go right over this and just leave that little orchid mouth coming out. So I'm working the shape, and I'm flowing a wash within the shape. I'm letting that flow into one orchid, flow into another orchid. There's a freedom to this. It can dry, I can always come back into it. As long as I have an idea of where the lights and the darks are, and I do, I started to build that up with those negative paintings. Whatever. Okay, and let's finish that shape. So I can come into a negative painting and start modifying some of the colors because I don't have this blue underneath those reds, so it's a little bit clearer. I have it here where the shadow is. And let's see. Nah, I don't want to do that there. Just wanted to force a bloom. I'm looking for a good place. Forcing a bloom happens when you paint with a color that's wetter. I'm putting it down on an area that's already beginning to dry, and that's going to give me a little edge here in the same way I got a little edge there. I kind of like that. I like it when the paint does that. So I have been working more into the flowers, and you can see this is what I had before. I was playing with the colors of the wash, finding some negative shapes, painting those in. Now I'm coming back into the flowers and I'm beginning to develop those. You can just do the whole thing negatively, never mind the color of the flowers, and just build it up like this, which is quite gorgeous. It depends on your own style. Okay, I worked a little bit more into the flowers, so I'm not going to labor those anymore. Now I want to think about really making them glow. And I'm not going to get them to glow by hammering them with lots of color. If I come in behind them with some colors, that's what's going to make the difference. So if I come in here with a low saturation green, that is going to make the red glow. So I can come back and forth with positive and negative painting based on what I want the colors in front to be doing. So I can come in here and you can see the red really starts lifting up and looking lovely against the dark, low saturation green. I thought when I started this, I was going to be doing a very quick little video just showing you, you know, some positive and negative spaces. And then I got involved. I always get involved. And so now it's become a little bit more of a painting. And I'm beginning to wish I was on better paper. Just a quick little view of where I am now, because my laptop and my iPad are just about out of power. So you can see how I've been developing washes, negative space, targeting little wash areas.